Greetings, Des King at kskdesign.com.au, and welcome to part two of my video on exercises in preparation for making a traditional Japanese shoji. In this video, we'll practice cutting the jaguchi joint and go through a couple of mortise and tenon exercises for making the shoji frames. So what's a jaguchi joint? Well, if you've read my first book, The Basics, you'll know that the jaguchi is a small extension on the front face of the rails that allows a 45 degree chamfer all around the inner edge of the frame. So in a sense, it's similar to a part of the joint left by a stacked rail and stile assembly bit for the router. For these exercises, you'll need a good cross-cut saw. I use the gyokcho 240mm razor saw. I also use my fine-tooth Kumiko saw that I used for the exercises in the last video. You need your accurate square, a sharp marking knife, marking gauge, pencil, and you'll also need what I call a jaguchi jig. Details of this jig are in book one, but basically all it is a piece of timber cut back at 45 degrees with a fence on one side. The first exercise is making the cuts necessary for the jaguchi. And this is simply sawing at 45 degree angle to the face. So for this exercise, we'll use the same piece of timber we used in the previous video for practicing our kumiko cuts. And I prepared this earlier, but as we did for those exercises, place five marks at about 5mm intervals across the face of the practice piece. Then with your marking gauge set at exactly 3mm, mark down from the face. That 3mm is the depth of our jaguchi cut. So remembering all of the techniques that we practiced in the previous video, place the heel of the saw on the line, then using your finger or thumb as a guide, gently draw it back to establish the curve, and do that a couple of times. Once the curve has been established, turn the saw over to 45 degrees, again using your finger as a guide, and draw it back and cut at 45 degrees, or roughly 45 degrees to the face. Once you've established the cut, leave the saw in, place the jaguchi jig on the piece, and move it across so that the face is against the blade of the saw, and continue cutting. And continue cutting down to the line. Again, place the heel of the saw on the line, using your finger as a guide, pull it across gently to establish the curve. Once the curve's been established, place the saw at around about 45 degrees and make the 45 degree cut. Once the cut's been established, place the jig on the piece, move it across so that the saw blade is up against the 45 degree face of the jig, and continue cutting down to the line. Once you've made those cuts, place another five marks on the practice piece, again at 5mm intervals. Now with practice, this process is really quite fast and quite smooth. And the last cut. So you can see with practice, this can be a very, very quick process. The next two exercises are practicing mortise and tenon joinery. In most shoji frames, the rails and stiles are joined with double mortise and tenon joints. All bottom rails are joined with the double mortise and tenon joints, but depending on the type of top rail used, some are, some aren't. In Japan, there are basically three different kinds of top rails used in shoji making, and these are described in full in Book 1, The Basics. The type of top rail that I normally use and the type of top rail we'll be using in the shoji we make in the next video is what's called a maruzan, and that always has the double mortise and tenons. The dimensions we use for these exercises are the same dimensions as those used in the Kanto region of Tokyo and its neighbouring prefectures. These are also the dimensions we'll be using for the shoji we make in the next video. For these exercises, you'll need a piece of timber 30.5mm by 30.5mm. That will represent the stile, and another piece 45mm by 29mm, and that will represent the rail. Now the first exercise we do is just a standard mortise and tenon joint. The dimensions of the mortises and tenons are shown in the following diagram. On the stile piece, you can see that the mortises are 6.4mm wide and 22mm deep. The first mortise is set back 6mm from the front, and the space between mortises is 6mm. The tenons are going to be marked from the mortises, and the tenons will be 21mm long. So with the dimensions I showed on the screen a short while ago, use your preferred method to cut mortises in the practice style piece. I cut my mortises with a router, and I prefer to square off the ends with a chisel. When squaring off the ends, one handy chisel I have is what's called a sokosarai chisel, sokosarai nomi. I bought this in Japan. This has got a little burr, almost like a little burr at the end, which is sharpened, and use that to scrape out the bottoms of the mortises. Mark back 21mm, and that's the length of the tenons. When marking the size, just mark fairly lightly. Mark the other face. And again, mark the side only fairly lightly. Place the rail on the style piece, making sure that the faces are flush. And you'll notice on the back there's about a 1.5mm offset. That's important. We need that, and you'll understand why when we make the shoji. But for the time being, make sure that the faces are flush and mark the location of the mortises. Move the piece and do the same on the back, making sure that the faces are flush. Extend the outer lines down to the shoulder lines that you cut before. And that is your depth of cut. Once you've done that, it's simply a matter of doing what we practiced in the last video, cutting on into a line. So place the heel of the saw on the shoulder line, pull it across, and continue cutting down to the line. Flip it over and do the same for the other face. Once we've done that, it's time to cut out the tenons. My preferred way of cutting tenons is on a tenoning jig that I made up for my my table saw. Once you've cut the tenons, clean up the shoulders and also between the two tenons to make sure that there's nothing left inside in between there that'll prevent the joint from fitting tightly. So once you've done that, then just chamfer all the edges of the tenons. For that I just use a kiwa-ganna. These are a beautiful plane. They're quite difficult to set up, but once they're properly tuned, they really are a wonderful plane. I go into quite a bit of detail in my book on how to set up the kiwa-ganna. And that's all there is. Now it's time to fit the joint and see how we went. So make sure the faces are on the same side. Give it a few easy taps. And that's not a bad joint. That's not too bad. The next exercise will be basically this, but with the jaguchi joint and a chamfer on the inside. Now cutting the jaguchi has to be done in a set sequence, and we'll go through that here. Book one goes into great detail and lays this out quite specifically. I'll use the same style piece that I used in the last exercise. The dimensions are exactly the same, and they're shown in this diagram now. This is the rail piece that we'll use. This is the key part, this is the front face. As we did in the previous exercise, mark back 21 millimeters, and that's the length of the tenons. With the previous exercise, we marked on the face first, and that was fine. This one, do not mark on the face. Leave the face alone at this stage. So we'll mark the sides, back 21 millimeters. Just mark the sides fairly lightly. Doesn't have to be a heavy mark. So mark the back face and mark the other side. Again, just a fairly light mark is fine. Okay, so you've marked three sides, hopefully only three, and you haven't marked the front. The next step is to take a ruler and mark 3 millimeters toward the end of the rail. It's 3 millimeters. Okay, make sure that 3 millimeters is towards the end of the rail. Don't mark it the other way, otherwise the joint won't fit together. That's the jaguchi mark. The front face is marked on that jaguchi mark. Once we've done that, same as before, make sure the two faces are flush, and then mark the mortise positions. And again, on the other side as well. Once you've done that, just extend the outside cheek lines to the tenon shoulder. Next, cut the jaguchi exactly the same way as we cut them during the exercises. The cut has to be down to the tenon shoulder mark. So once you've cut the jaguchi, flip it over and cut the tenon shoulder mark on the back face down to the cheek line that we marked before. Next, it's off to cut the tenons using your preferred method. For me, it's the table saw and my tenoning jig. After you've cut the tenons, clean the waste from the tenon shoulder, between the tenons, and also between the front tenon and the jaguchi. Be very careful when you're cleaning out there. Theoretically, it should be 3 millimeters, but quite often it's not. I use a 3 millimeter chisel that I've filed down. So that's around about 2.5 millimeters. And that leaves me enough breathing space on either side so that I don't damage the jaguchi. So just be careful when you're cleaning out inside there. So once you've cleaned that out, chamfer off around the ends of the tenons. The next step is to chamfer the front face of the rail on both sides. The plane I use is a Japanese kanna. It's a mentori kanna or a kakumen kanna. Okay, and that has an adjustable fence and gives tremendous precision when cutting, especially. For this joint to fit properly, this chamfer is absolutely critical. Just chamfer down to where the jaguchi joins the shoulder line, just down to about there. Then it really only requires very minor adjustment to make the joint fit. The key thing is that you can't plane too far, otherwise there's going to be a gap in the joint. But if you don't plane far enough, when you fit the joint, it's more than likely to split, and it'll split right along that grain line. So it's a very fine line between not enough and too much. And this is why it's critical that you practice quite a few times before actually making the shoji on it. For chamfering, I use my mentori kanna and a chamfering jig that I've made up, which is simply a V-groove, a 90 degree V-groove with an end stop to support the piece being planed. Dimensions and all the other details of this jig are in the in book one. It's a very handy piece of kit, this. So first we'll plane the front face on the two sides, planing down to that line or to that point that I marked before. Just take it very, very slowly and make sure you don't go too far. That's getting very close. Flip it over and do the other side. As I said, it's a very fine line between too much and not enough. Once you've done the front face of the rails, it's time to chamfer the front edge of the stile. Don't adjust the chamfer plane, and chamfer the front edge of the stile piece. Once you think you've got close to the mark, just give it a test run. Just be very gentle with it. Just tap it in. One side's still open a wee bit, so it just needs a couple more shaves. Just adjust the plane. Shave off the smallest amount. And try that again. In fact, that is close. That's not too bad at all. So after you've chamfered the rail and the stile, test fit the two pieces. And if your measuring, marking and cutting has been accurate, the two should fit together without any gaps and with a nice 45 degree chamfer on the inside. So now you know what a jaguchi joint is. It's this. The jaguchi joint is a critical process, and if it's done well, the shoji will look much better and much more professional than with a simple stock standard butt joint. It's also the way shoji are made in Japan. If it's not done well, the entire shoji will look very ordinary. So you should practice this joint a number of times before trying it on real shoji. It'll certainly save you much heartache and many frustrations down the track. Well, that's all for the exercises. Next is the real thing when we make ourselves a shoji. I'll do this over a couple of videos because even though it'll be a simple standard shoji, there's still a lot involved and a lot of processes to cover to make it properly. So thanks for watching, and I hope you'll join me in the next video when we begin making our standard shoji. I look forward to seeing you then.